Hey up, how you doing? Welcome back to Pretendship. You know what I never told you about? I never sat and told the whole thing start to finish. The tale of my journey to Indonesia. If you get inside, I'll regale you with a story of so many twists and turns, you couldn't even make it up. Episode 88, Pretendship, how you doing? I thought, you know, I get asked about this story sometimes. It's not particularly like, you know, the best riveting yarn or anything, but I am asked about it sometimes, and I'm so sick of telling it because it's a big long thing with twists and, you know, sadness, and there's a lot of sadness in there. So I'd like to just be able to have an episode I can just go, do you know what I mean? Check out episode 88. Don't ask me. People be like, what about this? And I'll be like, do you not watch every single episode, you piece of shit? Yeah, if you're hearing people in the background on occasion in this episode, by the way, I have in here with me good old friend of mine, Philly Deranged Sutton, and the old ball and chain as well. The old little... Yeah, the skeletal hand. So that if for watchers, people watching on the YouTube, you'll have seen their hands in there. Exciting already, isn't it, the story? Stop it. Bloody drunk off a sip of beer, aren't you?
Sorry.
I mentioned Tanya on the last solo episode. I was defending Your Honour because... She works in Starbucks, right? And then people will come in and go on about, they'll give made up names and expect, and so I was defending Your Honour for that. Like, so here's the actual story, unless you want to tell it.
Nice.
Someone came in and was like, can I have the fucking flappalapalachino? And then Tanya was like, oh yeah, what name is it? And she went, Irish. And Tanya goes, has the normal reaction that anyone would, like, oh, I mean, it sounds like she said Irish, but that's obviously not a name. So I'll just ask how to spell it rather than go, what's that, you know, what? How do you spell it? That's the politest way to deal with, like, unusual names, isn't it? So Tanya goes, how are you spelling that? And she goes, you don't know how to spell Irish. And my blood boiled for you, Tanya. Because you have to know that, you know, you're not going through your life going, my name's Irish, and people go, oh yeah, cool, nice to meet you, Irish. Like, unless they're trying to be extra... virtue signal, you're like, that's fine, and what's your pronouns? So, you know, you go, even me, Sutton, you lived in Dubai, right? Mm-hmm. And then he goes, they'll go, what's your name? I'll go, Phil, and then they'll put some, what will they put?
Yeah, they'll start writing F, and then I go, no, PH, and then they write Faf, because he thought I said TH.
Yeah, so, do you know what I mean? And then, are you upset, or you go, there's no one called Phil around here? That's fine. Mm-hmm. And that Irish... has got to have gone through a whole life. If a name is Irish, I very much doubt that it is. And I think she's done some sort of weird rebrand. People, no one's gone, oh yeah, cool, that's a name. I-R-I-S-S. Like, everyone goes, what? You're Irish, and what's your name though? And there's been all these miscommunications, and then to try and make my GF feel bad. But... in case, Tanya's in here, but in case Ana de Armas or Evangeline Lilly's watching, we are in an open relationship, and you can feel free to message me privately. Or...
good choices, those two.
It reminds me, actually, of that other one. So I'd been in London a weekend or two ago with Sutton and our good... go on. I've been down there just... you know, sort of trekking in the hills and stuff and having a good time with our old homie Jimmy Chirpsall, Ninja Warrior. And yeah, we'd been getting the coach to go down there, stepped up to get on the coach, and this guy's, you know, with the clipboard and stuff, and he goes, "Hurry, hurry, hurry." And I was like, oh, we're gonna need to ring an ambulance, this is someone's having a stroke. He goes, "Hurry, hurry," and I was like, oh fuck, what are we going to do about this? And I look at Sutton and back to him. I'm like, just one more time, please, mate. Sorry. And he's like, it's taken as is. And Sutton leaned in and went, tickets and reservation. Don't know how you understood that without subtitles on. And I was like, oh, right. And my blood was boiling immediately. I thought, right, you're Scottish. I'm not expecting Scottish, right? We're in Manchester.
Where are we?
I felt like saying to him, I was like, hey guy, smell. What is it? Oh, no haggis. What's that? Oh, no bagpipes. Do you know what I mean? Look at this. Oh, it's not a kilt, is it? Where are we, guy? We're in Manchester. My ears are not ready. If you'd have gone, if you're wearing the Scotland flag, then I'm like, okay, I'm ready to understand Scottish now. But I'm expecting like, oh, you all right, mate? Where you going? Are you going to Birmingham or what? I don't know why. Was I doing Mancunian or Scouse then?
Easily done.
It's one in the same, isn't it, really, ultimately? All these northern woolly backs. But he was even more northern and more woolen back. He was a Scotlandman. What is it? Scotch is a pejorative, isn't it? Scotch. They don't like that.
They don't like Scotch, think. Like
Scotchman.
Scotsman's fine. Scotch isn't fine.
Scotlandish man.
Right. And I wasn't ready for it. And I felt like going, even when, if I'm just saying something to someone, oh, we should go there after. And they go, what? I don't go, oh, we should go there after. I don't do the exact same sound. I go, oh, I'm just saying we should go, like, after this, we should go. I make it easier for them. That's when we are both from the same place and they're ready for my accent. This guy's just like, you got to come in. Doesn't care that, where are we? Where are we, guy?
Can you hear Oasis? Do you see Parka Jackets?
You feel me? He's a stand-up comedian, that's why. But yeah, I thought I'd tell this tale of, sorry, did I cut you off there? It is my show. I'm going to cut all your bits out. Tell this tale of when we went to Indonesia, which a lot of my friends will be sick of hearing about, so I don't begrudge you at all if you've tuned out by now, but I will be telling it in such painful detail that I defy you to have heard every single clause within it before. So how did it start off? It's such a unfortunate series of events all the way through from start to finish. So Tanya and I had planned to go travelling, you know, gap year, some of that action, but not the chundered everywhere kind, but more like that. I'm going to find myself, I'm going to wear harem pants. And it was going to be very much like that style of, you know, go Southeast Asia and see a turtle, all that sort of action, you know, what people do in their early 20s. So we thought, we'll go and do that. Saved up for ages to do it. I think we've always been interested in that part of the world as well, haven't we? And so it's between there and maybe a Japan or a Korea, you know, which you've done those anyway afterwards. We just decided we would go there. And you know, it's a fair whack to actually get over there, to jump over there on the plane. But then when you get there, you can just live like monarchy when you're over there, and everything's like 1p. So I thought, this will be sick. We can stay there for a good amount of time. You know, saved up for, this is before I was doing video work full time as well. So it took a good year to like scratch the funds together to actually go and do it. And then the trouble began almost immediately. We're in, you know, you have to transfer, right? So we're in Turkey, in Istanbul, and we've sort of seen that the planes go, oh, that's when the gate opened. Like, okay, chill. So we're like listening to tunes. Tanya's doing yoga on the floor in like a dark waiting area that no one else is in, and I'm just listening to tunes, just dancing. We're like, okay, we're on our way to the holiday. Let's do it. And then we go, okay, the gate's just opened. It's half one. Let's go. And we get there. That's not when the gate opens, half one. That's when the plane leaves. So I've never really been abroad before. I've been to like Mallorca, that's a piece of piss in it. Do you know what I mean? It's just like jumping on a bus to get to Mallorca. So I'd never done these long distance trips before. Tanya immediately registers the severity of the situation, but I'm just like, relax, brah, we'll just jump on the next plane. That's how I thought it worked. I thought they'll just, oh, you won that. Well, you are going to be late now by a couple hours, but you'll just get on the next plane. Turns out that's not how it works. So Tanya's sprinting through the airport and she's like kicking groups of Chinese tourists out the way, just get out. And I'm just like, this guy about Tanya, just like such a melodrama. Do you know what I mean? And she's like fighting people out the way, just rattling the desk like, excuse me, I don't care about your thing though.
I was distraught.
And then I was just like, it's cool. And she was like, no, Pete, we can't catch the next one. We have to get new tickets. And I was like, and then I match the level a little bit, but I was still trying to be like a rock for my baby. And I thought maybe I could jump on. I was having fantasies of like, we're going to jump on the baggage vehicle thing and like, drive across the tarmac and like jump on the plane, or you know what I mean?
They lie to you. You know, in like the programs where like Stansted Airport, and they film like the best moments where, because viewers are watching, the customer service would be amazing. If someone's like,
yeah, they don't care.
Late, they're like, come with us. And in my mind, I was like, maybe there's a chance that no. happened. Does it?
Yeah, I'd been primed, I'd been programmed to expect that type of service as well. And then they were just like, oh, you miss your plane. Oh. Okay, bye. Because, I mean, really, they're not in charge of the airport. It's just any one of us who works on that desk who's just like, someone else will deal with this. You're not my concern. So anyway, we've missed the transfers, which we found out also means, I think the flights back were cancelled. So these are return flights to Indonesia. So it's a good fare, like, grand, was it?
Mm.
They also cancelled the return flights. Wicked. And we'd planned to fly in to Jakarta, I think, make our way along the whole island of Java, so through like Yogyakarta, they call it, all the way through along, and then maybe jump over to Bali, or the Gili Islands would be on there. So we'd planned to make our way across the whole thing. We'd also booked a flight internally from the Gilis to maybe Bali or Yogyakarta or something. Like, we'd also booked another flight in there to help us get back to catch our return flight.
A separate flight.
But then doesn't even matter now. The return flights are cancelled to go back to like Dubai or wherever we would have landed. And we're just like, oh, okay, cool. So I was just like, well, I don't earn any money, so I can't afford to really buy a return ticket unless it's like 150 quid, because I've got some money set aside for the spends. And I was going to scrape by the whole time that we were there anyway. So I'm telling Tanya, listen, if this is more than about like 200, 300 quid, then we're going to have to like go home, really. And Tanya was like, we're not going home. I'm like, yeah, but I mean, I can't afford it though. And she was like, we're going to Indonesia. And I was starting to having to conjure up these ideas of, okay, so we'll steal. I was literally thinking while we're in the airport, like, so when we get there, I'm going to steal leftovers from plates and we'll have to sleep like on roofs maybe. And I was having all these thoughts, like, if it's any more than like 300 quid, we go and check for the ticket prices, and it's like over a grand again, just because we have to get the return flight, and it's like just as far to get from fucking Istanbul. So I was like, yeah, we can't go. And Tanya's just not having it. And
yeah, but you have to understand that it was such a build-up,
of course, yeah,
to get the plane. And I'd never been on like abroad.
Yeah, it would have been such a pussy old move to just go home then. But I was like, I can't, the money. Like, we should have just moved heaven and earth to make it happen. So I'm glad that you were doing it.
Mm-hmm.
We started, so it's the middle of the night here, and obviously we're ahead on the time zone. So we're trying to ring up people. We were trying to, but we had to wait till they woke up, people at home in the UK. We had to do bank transfers, and we're like transferring things from savings, but then it looks super suspicious because our bank's just registering money, changing accounts from Istanbul and shit, so that our accounts get frozen. So, and then we're like ringing up parents and ringing friends up. And
we also had to get a visa into Turkey.
Yeah, we had to buy a visa just so we could occupy the airport, and then we weren't allowed to leave the airport. So we're just trapped for what ended up being a long time as well. We're going hanging out outside cafes. I'm sure everyone's had some version of this when you go and, you know, you go to Thailand with the boys or whatever, but we're like buying the very cheapest thing from a cafe so that we could get some Wi-Fi, so that we can try and make these funds move around, so that we can get tickets to get to Indonesia. And we end up with sleeping on the floor and wait. And then it was like, okay, 3 hours until the bank opens. So then we can, and then we're just lying on the floor, people like stepping over us. There's not a quiet area or anything. We're just in the middle of the thoroughfare in the bright daylight with flies dancing all over our bodies, just exhausted, just like depressed. And that was, I mean, that was only like a few hours into the journey, wasn't it, at this point?
I remember being back home, because it felt like a big deal that you were going away for like, what was it, like a month? Yeah, no, we were all like, oh, they're off. And then within a couple of hours, like the next day, we're at Steph and Tanya's place, and Steph's like, on the phone, like, they're having trouble, you know. It's not going well.
Just fucked it immediately. Yeah. If that had been you, people would have been like, classics,
yeah,
and action.
He's gonna be dead anyway. That always happens.
So, I mean, we eventually made it happen, and, you know, we're still making sure that we don't get our hope up. Like, I'm not going to believe that it's happening until we land in Indonesia.
We were in the airport for 50 hours.
Just like semi-awake, yeah. Semi-asleep, just not able to really, like, get a kip. 50 hours we were in the airport. Then we finally got a plane and we were buzzing, like, that's all the end of the problems for this journey. And we get going and we land. We landed in Jakarta, which is right at the top of Java. And Indonesia is such an interesting country because all the signs are actually in the Roman alphabet because, you know, they've been colonized, I think, by Europeans. So they have the same, you can read the signs. It's not just like weird scrawl in an alien language that you might get if you go to China or Japan. It's just, you can read it phonetically out to someone that that lives there. And they'll be like, oh, yeah, yeah. So you could just go, Yogyakarta, and they'll go, ah, yes, Alamatidor. And then they'll just get you off to the thing. You know, immediately the first thing you notice for anyone that's been to East Asia or like, well, Southeast Asia, anywhere in Asia, really, I'm sure this probably happens in Europe and the Middle East and anywhere. But the roads are out of control. There's no lines on the roads, so cars are coming. Obviously, there's like one road going that way and one coming that way, but there's no lanes. So there's cars just like going in and out of each other, undertaking, overtaking, just going around. There's motorbikes orbiting the cars, just sort of circling around them, nipping through little cracks. It's chaos. Everyone's just beeping, beep, 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 beep. Like sonar, that's what it's for. It's not like angry, everyone's just driving around going, hey, so where are you from, Manchester? Beep, 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 beep. Just, it's sort of saying, I'm going to be here now, like, watch out for me coming up on the blind side. That's what everyone's doing. And you have to cross these roads. There's no place to cross. So Tanya and I just looking at it going, so, and Tanya's like, I've read, Pete, on the internet, you have to step, because Tanya researches all this. She's like, you can't wear pyjamas in public, otherwise that's disrespectful. So apparently the best technique is just step out into the road and just be clear, yeah, where you're going and maintain your speed, which is, it feels like, oh, so yeah, you just grab the lava, drink the glass dust and you'll be fine. It just feels so counterintuitive to what you know to do in the West, which is, oh, there's a car coming, don't cross. But it's like, there's always cars coming, cross fast. So you just like, ah, and you just scream and walk across the road. That was the first thing that struck me. Another one that reminds me of ah is they have the Adhan over there, which you must remember from Dubai, probably.
Adhan.
It's the call to prayer.
Right, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the Muzzers, they have the old, they have their that plays over the speakers every, what, few hours, like 2 hours or something. It played all day.
Yeah, I'm not sure how often, but it was frequent.
It's frequent. It's like every time we called to pray.
All the time. So this thing would play. I will say, though, when we landed, like, so is Jakarta the capital of Indonesia? Mm-hmm. The top tier singers they had on it. So it'd just be beautiful. You just sit at your window and you just hear this. And you go, ah, Moses. And I quite liked that part. As you move further away from the capital, though, the singers tend to not be as good now. So the further we got away from it, you'd always be like, this is definitely the B team on today.
Jolly Nailer pub singer.
Yeah, it's definitely the backup. It's the understudy on today. And it's that to be like, dead pitchy, the mics, so you just, and like the singers were not good, and they didn't have the, I don't think it's a song that you can learn, I think you're just meant to like feel it and flow with it. So some of these people are not very gifted vocally on melody interpretation and stuff, so they were just hitting the same like, and just like, oh, do you, because I know it's religious, so maybe everyone's just like, oh yeah, God is good, God is good. But if it was me and it's my mate doing that, I'd be like, maybe you just like mix it up a little bit, just play with it a little bit, a little few runs in there, you know. You know? So, yeah, I mean, where did we get off to? I think we went through to like, I can't remember what order this all happened in, but we started moving across towards Yogyakarta.
Before you move on to the next bit, while you're talking about Indonesian things, the thing that really interested me was the private thing you told me.
Another crazy thing about it. So, but in Bahasa, the common tongue of Indonesia, there's no word. This is as far as I'm aware. Maybe this is false, but I was led to understand that in Bahasa, there's no word for privacy, and that's because there's no concept of privacy at large, really, in the culture of Indonesia. So, and by that I mean, there's no sort of understanding that you have personal space that people are not to invade. You know, for example, you'll be on the train and then people are just like, strangers are just sort of sat next to each other, the legs over each other, and just like picking at your food, just like, and you're just like, no way. There's no understanding that you might not want that, and that we're not all, I mean, it sounds nice in a way, like we're all big, one big family, but I remember, you know, people would just get really close to your face and yeah, it's odd. There's also no idea really popularized there in like the zeitgeist about the spread of germs. I'm sure there probably will be more so now with the whole COVID thing, but I remember reading at the time that there hadn't been these same pushes in their you know, media in the 70s and 80s like we had, where there'd just be posters in the doctors and there'd be this and that and an advert and things at school about like, cover your mouth when you cough, don't sneeze right into someone's mouth. And so I remember there was one time this taxi driver's just talking to me, he's going, oh yes, so we can go to the, and I went, and I just felt like going, hey man, do you like this song? I was gonna kill Yeah, and I got ill immediately after that as well.
But I think that was a lot to do with your psyche being...
Oh, like psychosomatization. Yeah. Like, I felt so...
I think so.
Yeah, my body was like, get ill, because I didn't...
It stressed you out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mentally. Yeah, I feel you.
What's that word again? Because some people... I know what it means, but some viewers...
I of course know what it means. I won't explain it now, but you explain it now. What was the word that you're after?
Psychosomatization.
So I only know that because my little sister didn't go to high school. This is just a little tangent, but getting back to the story. My little sister didn't go to high school much because she was like all messed up, and I think she was starting to deal with... starting to understand that she was trans maybe, but there was no word for that back then, so she was just like, what's going on? And then she would get up and not go to school, and she was just like brutally anxious and depressed and didn't go to school for years, really. And then the doctor said, oh yeah, she's actually become like ill and can actually become sort of exhausted, and it's psychosomatic, which means the mental is affecting the physical health. So pardon me. Yeah, this boy needs therapy.
Yeah,
is it from that? Yeah, so where was I up to? There's not like privacy and stuff there, which was interesting to learn and then see it in action. That I'm sure there is personal space and privacy, but it's just not as respected. You know, in different countries, it dials up and down.
Doors exist, so there is.
Yeah, you can of course like close your house. It's not just like my house is your house. But yeah, it's definitely different, and you'll notice that. At one point we head over to this, we're in a little homestay, right? So that means just in the back bedroom of a family's house, right? Will you chuck me that chopstick, by the way?
Yes, I will.
Just get my refill on the scene. Wonderful. For those of you listening on Sunday morning, you got hammered last night. that's going to trigger some PTSD for you. But for the rest of you listening in the week and for the rest of time, maybe it'll make you go, ah, I want a drink. Thanks very much. Sounded sarcastic, but it's genuine. Yeah, so we head to this little homestay at one point. I'm not sure whereabouts it was. Do you remember?
Yeah, it was maybe about three, four days.
Do you, the town, perhaps?
Georgia County.
Oh, yeah, okay. So that's like the sacred city where you can go and see like where the king lives and stuff. And we're in there, this horrible little back room of some family, a nice family's house, like probably pretty good for where they live, I'm imagining. But it's all we could afford, definitely, because we're just scraping by with, you know, after all the palaver of, you know, what we'd had coming in there. So we're in this little place, there's cockroaches on the floor, and in the bathroom it's just open. You just see the sky, and it's like a little bucket of a toilet, and you can't flush it. You have to like throw water into the toilet. By the way, in a lot of places there's just squat toilets, so that's actually like could be pretty fancy where we were. In a lot of places it's just a hole. Like on the train there was a hole, and you can just see the tracks whizzing by. It's like if your leg fucking falls through there, it's like, you know what I'm saying? So you had to just, and our Western sort of European legs are not accustomed to just squatting all the time, so they're just super sweet with, like, it's just a relaxed position to them, for them to be just like ass to grass. But it hurts for us, and you're like, ah. And also you're like, where do I put my pants? I don't know where to put my feet. So you like take your pants off, you have to pull one leg off, step your foot back into your shoe, do the same with the other leg, hang your pants up so you can just take a shit onto moving train tracks. So So having a little bucket of a toilet in our homestay was like pretty peng tings. And then the fan doesn't work, and it's 45 degrees or some ungodly temperature like that. It was.
It's that much.
No?
No.
Might have been a real 30, feel.
35.
Yeah, 35, okay. I remember in Dubai, I remember getting off the plane at night, and it was something like in the low 40s at night, and I was just I was laughing because not only had I never experienced that heat before, but it was nighttime. I was like, it's never been this hot for me in a daytime in Mallorca, in anywhere before. It's hilariously hot in Dubai, but yeah, 35 still nothing to be scoffed at, Tanya. So, and the fan doesn't work, there's no aircon, it's just got this little rickety like fucking gas powered fan or something. Just awful it was. But we're like, oh yeah, we'll get out into the city. We'll, you know, make some plans. We'd plan to go to this Indonesian ballet. So that's this famous ballet I'd seen in the documentary Samsara. And we're like, yeah, front row tickets, let's go.
The whole day where we've gone exploring the royal palace, and then we met the...
Oh yeah, we had the
tour guide guy.
The Luwak, was it called?
That's why she's here.
All that shit, like the tour guide, we all that boring shit. I remember we got a Beichak, which is the little taxi motorbike thing, got that across town for like half an hour in the morning, seven, eight in the morning, right? 15 minutes we were in it, and we got off that into our room, and we were like sunburnt from just that little tiny bit of exposure. And we had the coffee from, you know, the monkey shit coffee, or the Sive.
Kopi Luwak.
All that, yeah, but... It did, yeah.
What did the monkey?
The little shitting monkey.
The luwak. Oh. They got it out and it went on.
We can't cover absolutely everything that we did, but yeah.
We had a good day.
We had a really good day, and then we're in the, so we booked the ballet tickets, and I remember this moment where, you know, we'd overcome these problems getting there. Oh, 50 hours, like all these thousands of pounds, but just forget about it. We're here now, and it's all good, and then. I remember vividly Tanya getting ready, you know, in the mirror. She's sort of across the room there, just like doing a makeup. Going, where should we sit, Pete? In the front row, or what's going on? I'm like, yeah, babe, I don't know. We're having the best time ever. And I look at the phone there, and I'm getting a text from Johnny Yule. Regular viewers, listeners will know Johnny from some of the other episodes. And he's like, I really wish I didn't have to tell you this, man. Like, it's not a joke. And it is important that he says things like that, because it could easily be a joke and our friend circle will do shit like this. But he goes, our mate, a good mate of us all, really, but he was especially a good mate to me and Tanya. Like, he was a brother to me, definitely. I'm sure to Tanya as well. And a good friend to a lot of us. Beef, we called him. Robert Henry, Robot Henry, I called him. had been knocked off his bike the night before on his way home for a party from a party by a drunk driver in a van. So he'd not really had any chance, and the guy had knocked him, and he'd gone into a lamppost. And I mean, they said, I remember at the time being told that he'd died in the ambulance, but then I think afterwards we were told that he would have died instantly, and I don't know how much of a kindness that might have been for him, obviously, but to be told that, you know, and because we obviously tortured ourselves with thinking that he suffered, or he was online for a little bit after it. But I read this, and I'm like, my first thought actually, and I don't know if this is like a fucked up thing, my first thought wasn't like, my brother is gone. I was like, how do I tell Tanya this now? And I seriously considered, like, okay, I'll smash my phone, I'll smash Tanya's phone, and I will psycho this whole holiday, like, yes, I'm having a wonderful time, and just pretend that I don't know, and not let Tanya find out so that she can enjoy this thing that she was so, you know, vehemently attached to making sure happened, even after all, everything, you know, with the, you know, getting stuck and the money and stuff. Obviously, I couldn't do that. I had to tell her. You know, it was only a few minutes before I was like, you know, I checked with Johnny. I was like, be real now, man, because I'm going to tell Tanya this, so it's fucked up if this is a joke. And he was like, I wish it was a joke, man. And props to Johnny, because I don't know how I would break that news to someone. You did it for everyone, man. I asked him if he'd go around to my parents' crib and tell them, and they're crying in front of him. And
props to you, Johnny, because that was respect for that.
Yeah, you're a good lad. And yeah, I'd never had anyone die that I gave a fuck about before. You know, I'd had like a couple grandparents maybe, but you know, they just go, grandma's dead, and you go, sad. I don't know, I'm sure for a lot of people you would be sad, but I'm not particularly close with any of my family. I've only ever had my, you know, my unit, like these guys and a lot of, I mean, probably some of you listening, but you know, we've got a tight little, you know, the inner circle of, you know, two dozen people that's our adoptive family. And we're at that age, I'm sure everyone remembers, where you're invincible, and you know, none of you have to look after your health, and you're all like untouchable by mortality. So it was the first proper death that I'd experienced, and I had no idea how I was going to break that to Tanya either. And I remember inviting her to, this isn't funny, sorry, to doesn't need to be funny, yeah, just suddenly taken a bit of a heavy turn, hasn't it? Yeah, I go, Tanya, you're going to have to come over here, mate, and sit down. And she's like, what? I think she can tell something's wrong immediately. And I go, yeah, just sit down. And I go, yeah, I don't know how to say it, so I'll just tell you that Beef's been knocked off his bike last night. And then I'll never forget your face when I tell you that. And then I couldn't look at you anymore, actually. So I think I pulled you in, and I'm like embracing you, and we're both already crying. I think we both know what's up already. And I go, and then the ambulance came, but I was in that sentence to sentence trying to pussyfoot around saying what had happened. And when the ambulance has come, but he's not. And I just remember Tanya going like, he's not. And I couldn't even say it, so I just nodded. And then we just both, you know, obviously he was screaming. And then Tanya's, you know, she's saying, this isn't real. And I remember a thought crossing my mind like, oh no, she's broke. Like her brain's malfunctioning now, because this is such heavy news. And then, you know, we were in that little room for, I mean, it felt like a week, but I mean, it's got to have been 2 or 3 days. We didn't leave or get food or drink, and we'd cry for a little bit, and then we'd go to sleep, you know, drink some water because we're fucking dehydrated, we can't even cry anymore. And we go back to sleep and then we just wake up and cry again. And I've sort of blocked it all. Do you remember much about that, those couple of days? Mm-hmm. I barely remember them now. I just...
The only part I really remember is the time that we went out to get some...
Oh, yeah, we'll get to it. We'll get to it. Don't jump ahead in the chronology, Tanya. Oh, and then we went back to the room after that. I just remember, like, feeling as if, oh, we, you know, we can't be there for everyone right now, everyone else that's suffering through this. And we were like, are we going to try and go home right now? And then I was like, you need to, you know, I'm texting Johnny, like, you keep us updated on the funeral, like, when that is. And if the funeral's happening, then we'll come back. And sort of feeling like, oh, it's so, in a way, it's awful that we can't be with everyone right now, but in a way that would, there'd be no distraction from it. And I think we welcomed the opportunity to be distracted from it. And, you know, it definitely now was very clear that the trip was not going to be what we'd intended it to be, what we wanted it to be, but it could be this new, unusual, life-altering experience that you would never ask for. But it was so unusual to be like around paradise beaches and, you know, these crazy temples and, you know, this crazy new fruit you've never heard of and a monkey kisses Tanya on the cheek, but we've been bereaved at the same time. It was like a really fucking weird, riggy experience.
Yeah, I remember being, us at home, if you were worrying that, like, oh, we can't be there for everyone, we were all like, oh shit, they're all trying to enjoy this holiday and this is happening.
But oh, fuck the holiday, we were like,
well, what I mean is,
spoiled my holiday, beef.
I did that wrong. What I mean is, they have to deal with this while they're...
It's Gay Pride Month, Sutton. Where are we?
We're in Scotland. When you're in the...
We were all right. I think we had it the best out of everyone.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, our thought was like, oh, it's a shame that they're in this place where they have to find out about it there,
yeah,
rather than at home. But also, I had this feeling of like, you're really going to deal with it there, though. Like, not only do you have distractions, but you're in a completely different place where you have time to kind of process it.
It was so weird. I really wish that we could be, you know, just teleport back and just be with you guys all together, you know, mourning together. And we were walking down the street in what otherwise would have been like, let's take some pictures of this. And then, do you remember, we were just walking back one time and I just went, just like crying in the street in the day. You know, it just feels really weird to like, it's not at the end of a night out, you're just crying in the street in the day.
Yeah.
You know, I'd planned this sick video that we spent ages planning before we went.
Oh, yeah.
So Tanya and I had planned to do this dance choreography thing. Yeah. Where we went out and filmed her dancing in a field before we went, and I split that up into frames, and then we were going to recreate each of the frames. I'm sure there's probably an easy way to do this, like just film her dancing everywhere, but we were going to split it up into frames, and then I was going to film her in the street, you know, like, let's do frame 1 to 48 now, and then she'll like this, take a picture, and then, but like step back, so she was like doing the dance, but like flying down the street while she's doing this dance. Yeah, then flick, now we're on a beach, now we're in the woods, now we're in the city, now we're in the slums. Just like, it was going to be this tour of Indonesia and the conduit, the sort of, the format, the structure, the framing device of it was this dance by Tanya to this like tune that it was going to go viral, kid, honestly, like, I'm telling you. And then we'd already shot a little bit of that, which was super difficult, by the way. Like, I'm with the phone and the camera on the tripod and going, okay, step back a little bit, shoulder up, elbow down, but shoulder up. Not elbow up at the same time, elbows down. Turn your arm out, trying to recreate these, like, thousands of pictures. So I'm sort of glad that we didn't do it, but it would have gone viral, kid, I'm telling you. And then, so immediately we're like, okay, so we're definitely not doing that then. There's no chance that we're like, so are you, paradise, and dee-dee-dee. There's no chance of that. It was weird, but it was good to be distracted, I think, by this environment. It's a very unusual place to mourn, but I remember the first time we came out of the joint that we'd been staying in, just to, like, we have to get water or else we'll die. And then we seen a guy, and I remember immediately as we left this place, we were like, Oh, so we're not invincible then. And we had this overwhelming sense of like, now we're also going to die for sure. Like, how are we not also going to die now? I just thought, this is it. The whole squad's going to get this one by one, final destination. And doesn't help that on these Baychaks, the motorbike taxis, and it's not like a Thailand motorbike taxi where the motorbike is in the front and then you've got a carriage in the back. It's not that. It's a motorbike with a park bench fucking stapled to the front, blue tack to the front of it. So the guy's just like, I remember the guy just being like this messed up, like he just, no, not because he's Asian. Because he works outside all day, right? So he's super brown. His eyes are just like, just leather, just slits in leather,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I'm not saying he's a slit eye. I'm not saying he's a slit. And he's just got this like walrus mustache and like three teeth just like coming out. And he's just like, yeah, water. And then, so we jump on this bench and we're going, and he's driving down the, so there's nothing in front of you. You're just flying down the road on a bench, right? And then he drifts, do you remember this? Drifts into oncoming traffic and we're going, ha ha ha, like, can't tell if he's asleep. Not because he's Asian. Like, we're looking up like, excuse me, pal, I don't fall asleep. And then he drifts all the way across incoming traffic onto the pavement. So then we're dodging.
So he's a bad driver now?
No, not because he's Asian. And then there's like lampposts and post boxes and stuff. They have post boxes there now, don't you know? And then we're just dodging all these things on the pavement. And we were just convinced we were going, oh, for the whole rest of the holiday. It doesn't even, it feels like weird to call it a holiday now. For the trip, for the adventure of a lifetime, we felt like we were going to perish at any moment. We got there in the end, we got the water. By the way, do you remember this? Everywhere that we'd, I'm asking Tanya for the listener, I gestured off screen. Do you remember that we kept hearing, do you want to know what love is everywhere? You were like, let's go, it's the biggest fish market in Asia, let's go. And so we go to this like market where there's, you know, bird cages and someone shelling a pheasant out into a grid and just like silks and spices from around the globe. And then I'd just be like, listen to what's on the tannoy. Economy between the lines, just like this same tune. And then we'd be on like a coach going somewhere just like, before I feel it when I'm older, like, in my life, like, just this, they love this song in Indonesia. It's like, it's the only song, it's like always in the charts forever. And I remember one time we were trying to ask someone like supermarket and we had the translator and we're going, like whatever supermarket is in Indonesian. And we're going, what? And then they're getting people, this guy's getting people to come and help like translate, like, do you know what these guys are saying? And I remember the guy, one guy came over and he had his phone. I thought he was on the phone, right? And then he's like, sorry, what? And he's trying to talk to us and going, yeah. And I realized he wasn't on the phone. He was listening to music because it was still playing and he was just holding it to his chest. And I went, and it's like, I want to know what love. And I went, Tanya, everyone loves this tune in Indonesia. This
wasn't
is
that around the time that you would just sing it in a Scottish accent all the time?
It was especially weird because I always, before I even went.
I remember you saying to me once.
Did we even go to an Indonesia, you know, or was it just a simulation?
Yeah, it was like a weird obsessive compulsive thing for you where you would sing it every day without fail. I have that where if I'm anxious, I repeat a phrase or sing an annoying song in my head repetitively. And it was almost like that for you. So it's almost like...
Yeah, they were doing my song.
Yeah. And it's like trying to get in your head the Indonesians.
Yeah.
Not because they're Asian.
Not because they're simulation. So we're back out in the world now. Like, we have to apologize. So we write a letter to the homestay that we stayed at, translated it on Google, you know, like, sorry for the noise, we've had a bereavement and we're gonna go home, because I think at that point we thought we might go home, right? So I think we'd said something to intimate as much. So we gave them this little letter, and the owner of that, like, the family must have been thinking, the white people are crazy, they're just crying in the room for 3 days, what's going on? So then we like passed them this little letter and they read it, and the guy, you know, culture, there's a bit of a culture clash there, so they don't know what's acceptable and what's not. And he just looked up after he'd read it and just shook our hands, just like, that was how we, remember that?
That broke you as well, that would break me.
Yeah, we were pretty broken for a little bit, and we were like, what are we gonna do here? Because we CBA just going, trying to do stuff now. We wanted to check out, you know, oh, let's go to Padang Bai, let's go to Prambanan and all the places that you would go. Those are real places, not because they're Asian in Indonesia, right? And we're doing shit like, you know, oh, we'll get in a taxi and then the guy's trying to take us, like, oh, I know the good price. And he's taking us for ages in one direction to like his house. And then we're like, fuck this, this isn't real. And we're like walking lost back to town. And then he's like driving, beeping, just like, come on, I take it. And there's all sorts of weird shit going on. Another weird thing that happens in Indonesia is they're burning litter everywhere. Like you're on the train, you're on the, just walking the streets. There's just piles of shit just burning in the streets. Do you remember this? Mm. You just smell burning garbage everywhere. What else are you meant to do with it? Because then it's not getting recycled, is it, for the most part, if you look into it? Plastics are not getting recycled.
Recycle system, the government doesn't.
Over here, it's not getting recycled. So that's why it goes all over there.
What do you mean?
Things that say they're going to be recycled are sometimes not even recyclable, and most of it doesn't get recycled. It's something like 90-odd% of stuff can't even be or never gets recycled. Yeah. Half of all the plastics ever made have been made since 2005. It just goes in the ocean, turns into microplastics, fishy, it goes back into our diet. There was a study recently that said people can consume as much as a credit card's worth of plastic every week or something. It's like, it's ridiculous. So, yo tengo cangrejos. So yeah, they're burning shit in the street, which is a weird one. And then really weird, you'll be in absolute abject poverty, just people who've never even heard of shoes before, and just like, you're just like, aren't they quaint? Look at that one, it's got no shoes. You know, just doing your gap year, like, take a picture of it, Tanya. And but then at the end of that street, there'll just be the golden archways, McDonald's, and a new one, not one with all the cartoon guys in there, like one that we would have just there, and that's just like this palace at the end of the street. Like, it's pretty insane. We make our way along. Still thinking we're going to die all the time. There's this guy, do you remember Yasser? Mm. There's this guy, we stay at this place, we've got food poisoning at this place. But there's this young, sort of tubby lad called Yasser that's working there. What's up with you, man?
Just
laughing, I don't know. But there's this guy, and we're chatting, and he's saying like he loves smoking weed, and he's like, do you like weed? I'm like, oh, we could get some weed, or what do you reckon? And he's like, yeah, you just can't get caught with it though, otherwise they'll kill you.
Yeah.
That's the law over there, just caught with weed, any drug, but even weed, they'll just come and kill you in the street. That's the government, not like drug, like gangs, cartels. Like the government will come, and lawfully everyone will be like, this is good, what's happened here today, and they'll just, and you'll just drop dead if you have a token of joint. This guy's bragging about it. I'm like, is he an informant? Like, yeah. No, we don't. Never weed. I've never had only vitamins. What is drugs? Do you remember that? Where are we? So this guy, I think he's offering us like rice wine. Raki, was it called? Arak?
Reiki. Oh.
Arak. Reiki, is it also that?
Oh, no, that's that thing, isn't it?
Reiki healing. Yeah, Arak, I think it was called.
Right.
So it's like rice wine or some shit, like the local, what you have if you're trying to get fucked. And he's given us a little bit of that. He's having it. What?
Reiki.
We're rapey.
My two drinks are all right.
You okay? You sneezing on yourself?
Yeah.
Everyone's hammered in here, you know. They're on the tinnies. Anyway, I only mentioned this guy because he came back while we're just chilling. Like on, I think this might have been your birthday that this was. On your birthday, though?
We just arrived.
Okay. And then the guy, you did have your birthday while you were there.
Yeah.
Not like completely mistaken. And then, he comes in, hammered, his eyes just lolling about in his head. And he was like, and he'd been eyeing up my camera. He was like, you can take some pictures of me with that, yeah. And I was like, oh, yeah, I mean, yeah, if you want. And I'd said, I think we agreed afterwards or before that, maybe I'd already suggested taking pictures for the hotel. I was like, we could take some pictures of this and you can put it on your Airbnb and it'll look cool on the thing. And then he was like, take some pictures of me from Facebook. And I was like, oh, okay. But his eyes were all fucked. He was just like, again, not because he's Asian. and he's like, he gets his cigarette out and he's like lighting a cigarette, like, take it now. And I was like, oh, maybe the light's not right and maybe he's changing face. Like, not to Caucasian, but like, let's... It didn't look good for the picture, but I cracked off a few pictures. And then I was like, okay. And I got the SD card. I was like, you got a laptop or what's... And he was like, oh, no. And I was like, how did you think these pictures would go to you? Do you know what I mean? How are you going to get them if you haven't got a card reader? And he was like, oh. And he was like, oh, I've got it. Yeah, my mate will have one. And I went, oh, okay. And he was like, oh, you come with... Because I didn't want to give him my SD card. Like, not that, not because he's Asian. but I was like, oh, yeah, I'll just come. Like, if we're going around to your mate's house or whatever, he's got a laptop. But yeah, it wasn't walking around to his mate's house. We jumped on his little moped. Everyone's got mopeds there, right? So I'm on the back of his moped, just razzing it round town, and he's just driving around. There's no mate's house that he's going to. He was checking in every like computer shop and just going like, and I'm just like holding the SD card like this. Do you have anything for this? A slot I can put this? And they're like, like never heard of it before. So going to the next one, the next one, the next one, just driving around for ages. And then didn't manage it, just like Yasser just driving around hammered on his little fucking thing off Iraq. And we get back to the hotel like, sorry mate, I guess the, you know, I'll post the pictures and give you a link, you can save them off there or whatever. And I think we ended up getting like, we had to like knock on a different hotel stayer's door, someone else that was there at the hotel, like some German guy had a laptop, and then we got it and sent it across or whatever. It's a boring story.
But I'll tell you what is a good story though.
Go on.
When you saw the spider.
Oh, we'll get to that.
Okay.
Nice though, a little foreshadowing. That's what they do in American TV. They go, 10 minutes from now, this will happen all the way through. Like every 5 minutes, they're like, please don't stop watching. This is going to happen later on. There's so much more left to the tale. What happened? Oh yeah, so we stayed at, we wanted to go and visit Ijen, it's called, which is an active volcano and a sulfur mine. So we went to stay at this place, I think it was called Tommy's, an Australian guy called Tommy. And we stayed there, which is where I developed the complex about having a shower, because it was this open bathroom with no curtain or anything. So I'm having a shower, just not being sexy at all. You know, not showering like, ooh, this is, I'm getting so clean. Like, I was just like, fat belly, just like, you know, just like the shittest, ugliest showering ever. And then I'm like rotating in the shower, which is what I do. I know some people face it, some people face away. I rotate, I'm like a microwave. And then I was like, turn around, and Tanya's like looking, and I was like, oh my God, I've never looked less sexy than right now. And Tanya's like, just looking at me, and I'm just like, oh, fuck.
And you didn't look bad at all.
I looked really bad. I appreciate you saying it. I looked grotesque.
Impossible.
So, and to this day, I'll be in our shower at home, door closed, curtain drawn, and I'm like, and I like look around to check that Tanya's not like round the curtain. Like, it's years later it is. Spoilers, because you know for sure that we made it out of Indonesia and we didn't die in Indonesia now. So we stayed at this place in, was it Padangbai? Banyuwangi.
Banyuwangi,
where the passion fruit grows sweet. So we had to stay somewhere around there to go to Ijen, right? The volcano place, and you.
Ijen, where the men come from. Ijen.
So we have to set off at like 4 a.m. or something. It's ridiculous, and we're hiking up this thing, and the air is thin. Like, it's pretty high. If you Google it, it's like a few thousand feet, right, or meters. What I mean, it's tall, and it's like you can notice that you're getting tired quick up there. And by the way, there's people, local men, right, carrying sulfur from down inside, right next to the volcano, which we're all wearing masks because like you have to wear a mask otherwise you'll die basically. And those guys are just all chilling, just like in sandals, smoking cigarettes, carrying 80 kilograms of sulfur up and down this absolutely ridiculous plank of wood with two like baskets.
Wasn't
on the end
in samsara as well?
Also in samsara. Yeah, definitely getting exploited and like not making enough money, but it was just like mega interesting to watch. You can't deny that. Yeah, just like in flip-flop, wearing like boots because you're hiking up and down like uneven rock, and they're just like barefoot, just walking up and down. And it's a trip that it would be difficult to do once, and they do it like multiple times a day, and they'll get paid like £5 at the end of the day, and they all die at 40 from lung disease. And then, like, I think you'd read like, oh, apparently if you want to take a picture of one of them, you have to give it a cigarette. And then if it accepts the cigarette, it denotes friendship.
Oh, that's what you want, sir.
Oh yeah, so we had a little a little happy creature of a man, Iwan, who gave you the nickname Tani. He was like, what is your names? And I was like, Peter and Tanya. And he was like, Tani? And we went, no, Tanya. And he went, oh, Tani means farmer. And we were like, that's what I'm going to call my girlfriend for the rest of time. You know that, don't you, Iwan? It was tight as well because the guy was sick and he was really funny and he was making jokes like, I'm not Brad Pitt. And he was making all, you know, these well-practiced patter that he must do with everyone. And then we were like, we have to get in touch with this guy. And we found him. We scoured the internet for him for ages. We're like, his name's Iwan. And I looked at 10,000 people.
Presetio.
Yeah. So yeah, he always comments on my shit in gobbledygook, yeah, and I'm just like, that's right, brother. And he's like, I'm like, I couldn't agree more, Iwan. But I went and found him. I literally was on, like, every day I'd be like, right, I'm going to do an hour of trying to find Iwan, because we didn't have any money at the time and we wanted to tip the guy at the end of, he was like, see you later. And we were like, bye. And we felt so bad. Like, that guy was sick and he must subsist on tourist tips, and we've not given him any tips. And I was like, we need to find him and just send him just a little bit of money. So we spent ages just Googling every single one, and we were Googling like Indonesian surnames and like trying different surnames and looking, scrolling through all the, and they all look the bloody same, don't they?
because
they're Asian. So yeah, we actually found him in the end, and sent him some money, which I wish that we'd been able to. We tried to do it one time when we'd been in Croatia, right? So we'd been, this is again just a little tangent before we go back to Indonesia. Tani. So me and Tani had been to Croatia, right? And we'd had this idea that we were in a wild camp to save money again. So we thought, oh yeah, we're going to get a little dinghy. We're going to go out to the islands where no one can see. And it's all right. Tanya's been looking on Google and it's okay because it says that there's unexploded landmines. We'll do it, we'll save money. Bears, wolves, unexploded landmines all over Croatia. And we were like, that's what we'll do. But we couldn't do it. So we went to a little campsite at one point and we're in there and we're getting on famously with the guy. You know, I go in, I'm exhausting the extent of my Croatian, and I was like, what do you think I'm doing? Just like speaking Croatian to him, and he's buzzing over it. And like, he's going, oh, where are you from? And I'm like, from England. He's like, oh, I thought you were Bulgarian. You speak like, it sounds like one country over maybe. And I was just like, yes, this guy, get it. Like, me and this guy, we're doing all right. And we're having a good time in Omish, this is called, if you want to look it up, beautiful little place, just sort of near to Split, a little south from there. And then we're just having a good time while we're there, chilling on the beach. And then I'm trying to work out while we're there, trying to keep them gains. So and it's embarrassing to like work out just out in the open, like doing press-ups and shit. So I find a little utility hut in the middle of this campsite and I'm like, I'm going to do it in here. I'm going to get a keg, do curls with that and do some sort of like exercise, skip maybe in this little place. So I get in there and I slam the door because I've got earphones in. I don't want anyone coming in and being like, oh, heavens. So I like kick this door shut and I'm like working out in there and then I'm trying to open the door and it won't open. I'm going, oh my God. Oh no, and I start pulling it and it's ripping the door. Like it's a thick wooden door and it's like exploding, the splinter in the door. Like it's staying closed and I'm just sort of pulling the handle out and the top's coming. I was like, oh fuck. So I can't text Tanya because this was like before roaming was just like given to everyone for free or something. I can't remember what happened, but I couldn't get in touch with Tanya. Tanya's like off picking shells down the beach or something. So I had to like bust the window open and climb out of this thing. And by that time, it's time to go from this campsite. So we're trying to find the guy that we've made friends with. And we were like, hello, like banging on caravans and hello. I'm like, well, the bus is gonna, we're gonna have to fucking bounce, aren't we? So we just split from the campsite without paying. Like,
split,
nice. So he'd said even like, as we made our tent, he was like, oh, it's starting to rain. You make your tent, pay at the end. And then we just fucked off, like ripped him off at the end. And he must have been like, these honkies. But we tried to find that guy, but it was like this tiny little campsite, didn't even have an address, so we couldn't send that guy money. But we did send Iwan money, so I feel happy about that. Pass me that little chopstick, man. Thanks, brah. Just getting the old refill on the scene. Quicker, woman! Where are we? But yeah. Not in Scotland. We went to Egen. Thanks very much, my darling. Which is incredible. You should check it out on YouTube. It's like, it's got blue flames and it's just like, it's an intense thing you've got to check out if you're around there. But yeah, we split from there, and we go on to the next place. We were like, we'd been toying with the idea of going to Bali, but it was going to be a bit much, wasn't it? When we were in mourning, and we were just not, it wasn't time for partying. So we were like, let's just cross over Bali. You know, we're not trying to get down with all the it's a lot of Australians on holiday, people from all over the world treating it like a Bangkok or something. So we were like, let's not go there. Let's head over to these little islands called the Gili Islands, right? Of which there are three: Gili Trawangan, Gili Air, and Gili Menno. Is air, is that, is it like air or is it just air? Like the British word air. So there's a party island there, there's a sort of more very chilled out, nothing-y island, and there's like a couple island. Those are three family different one. Yeah, family island, right? So we go, let's not go to, well, we do land on the party one. These Gili Islands, by the way, really insane history. I think they were sort of prison islands for the local, like either Bali or Lombok, which is the big island next to it with the volcano on it, which was a huge island, and they have Komodo dragons and shit on that island. And people who would be thrown in jail would go over to the Gili Islands and they'd be like, work on there, go on the plantations there and just get some sugar going, or some I think it was coconut plantations, right? So they're just like, get us loads of coconuts, lad, and don't leave because you're in jail, yeah? And then what would happen is they'd set it, this is like in the 40s or 50s maybe, and then they'd leave, go back to Lombok, chill. They'd go back every year or so, like, you better still be in prison doing prison stuff. And everyone would just be chilling and not doing, getting coconuts. They'd be like setting up little bars, and tourists would be coming and be like, I fucking told you, you're in prison, haven't you? Like, you promise, scouts honor, you're going to do prison until I come back next time, yeah? And they come back, and every time they came back, families were starting to be there, and the population was growing, and there was little things popping up, and they go, I've said no hotel, you're in prison, aren't you? And then what they would do, as the hotel started to pop up, the Lombok, like the officials, the government there, would burn the hotels to the ground. They would come and just burn all the businesses to the ground. So the Gili Islands are full of these like old, abandoned, burnt down hotels. It's really weird. If you go, I'm sure not on Trawangan, which is the party island, but if you walk around the maybe there and the other islands, you'll just see these old fucked up like hotels, which is because descendants of prisoners essentially have made these little businesses. And then Lombok officials come over and just go, I'm not here, remember in prison. So it is crazy being there as well and being like, that old guy, maybe he was a prisoner, or like, you are definitely the daughter of a prisoner, or. But yeah, so we stayed on these little Gili Islands, where there's like an embargo. Well, they don't let motors on the island, so there's no cars on the island, there's no motorbikes, it's just you can cycle, and there's very little in the way of like Wi-Fi or phones, even computers and shit, electricity. It's just these, I mean, it's pretty remote considering that it's a popular touristy destination. You can walk across these islands in like a matter of an hour or so. There's just like all these cats all over the island with chopped off tails, like every single cat has a little stubby tail, and there's just fucking snakes and aloe vera and scorpions and all sorts going on these little islands, right? So we're chilling in these, what was it called? Papaya, the place that we stayed at, and these little wooden huts, right? And yeah, we sort of made friends with the guys that work there, because we'd go around to the front and they have their own, you can like go and buy banana pancakes for breakfast and stuff. And there was a cute guy that worked there. We'd noticed all these cats with the cut off tails, right? So we're in the restaurant one night and the guy comes over and he's like, oh, hello, can I get you? And we're not, because he's Asian. And then we went, yeah, can I ask a question, please, friendo? How come we've noticed all the cats on the island have cut off tails? And what is that? And he was like, ah, yes, the cat, and then cat, and gone, and all the cat with the, and then cut, 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 cut. And we were like, listening to him, and he was going, yes, and the cut, and then, what, tail, cut, cut, cut. And we went, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then he left, he like walked away from the table, and I just turned to Tanya and went, now we know. And Tanya started laughing immediately, which the guy, it doesn't sound good to the guy, because he's like, what
no, thing? I stifled a laugh.
Like that.
Yeah, I had to keep it in, and it was one the worst laugh.
But we were afraid after that he wasn't our friend anymore.
Yeah,
right?
He definitely sensed that we were like, just.
Didn't know what he said. Speak English, you bloody. Do you know what I mean? If you're on planet Earth, you speak English, mate. But yeah, I mean, those guys that worked there were really friendly. Like, we'd had a.
When we left the island, we met.
Don't skip ahead.
Yeah, but
We did, yeah, we met up with it, yeah, before people were like worrying about the guy. We saw him as he was leaving, he's like, I'm leaving now to go back to the, and we were like, oh, it's good to see you, mate. Ah, we hugged him, which weirdly, in as I remember it now, I'm like, COVID. If you remember embracing strangers in your memory now, you're like retrofit the memory with COVID. So yeah, those guys were pretty cool that worked there. I remember one time we'd seen a spider in the room, I say spider, but it was like a tarantula. It's like this big, and you could hear it like running around in the room. And I was like, you shouldn't be able to hear a spider running about. So I was like, oh, I don't know if this is, just have these, or is this like unusual? And they'd be like, whoa, what the fuck is that? You know, it's like, I don't know. So I went around to the front and I was like trying to make myself understand. There's a spider. Don't mind about the spider, but just wondering if it's dangerous, if it's poisonous, let me know if it's, just let me know if it's no big deal, and then we'll just ignore the spider.
No, and then, what are you talking about?
What?
Don't just leave it. I was petrified.
Yeah, you didn't. You were like, I can't go to the bathroom. I didn't want to throw you under the bus, but you were being a real soft shite.
It was huge.
It was a big spider. Yeah, it was like a fucking beige leather glove with a mind of its own, just turning it about in the thing. So I was like, can you just take a look at the spider? And then I thought maybe he'd come in and go, oh, it's just, it doesn't matter about that. We go, oh, thanks anyway, mate. Or he'd go, oh, we'd never have those. So he came in and he was like, he did react to it like, you know, the Louis C.K. bit where he rings the guy that deals with bats, yeah. The Batman, and the guy just goes, I've got the bat now. Yeah. And you go, oh, now I feel emasculated that's all that needed to be done. And I tried to, like, it was hovering over the bathroom door, wasn't it? Like, where the little, well, the bucket that we used as the toilet, and it was just chilling, and you'd be convinced that it was going to go, ha, 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 and, like, jump down at you. So the guy came in, and he was, like, we were chasing it around, and I swear to God, it was abseiling and Spider-Maning across. It was, like, going, and swinging. Was it not?
I wasn't in there when he was catching it.
Back me up, though. Yes, it was. It was doing those things that I've claimed.
And Tobey Maguire. It was Tom Holland.
The guy slammed a cup down on the spider at one point. Bang! And then he looked and it was just one of its legs and the spider had just like fucked off. It was just like, have the leg, kid, I'm not arsed. And then I think he caught the spider in the end, did he?
Yeah, yeah.
Can't even remember what happened. Yeah, that was a mad one that happened there. Yeah, there was loads of mad shit on that island. It was like, do you remember there was the guy that kept trying to offer us weed, and we'd been thinking about weed ever since the thing with Yasser, and we were like, I bet it's cool out here though, because people seem to be a bit more like smoking weed, and we've been offered mushroom milkshakes at one point. And I was like, maybe we should buy weed off this guy, and he kept like blagging us. He was like, come on, come on. And I was like, we'll tell you if we've decided that we want weed. What about that? And I remember him being like quite forceful with us and keep coming back, and he was like desperate for us to buy weed. And then we found out, I don't know if we found out of him or someone else at some point, but he turned up one day and he was clearly lit. He was just like floating down the beach, and we were like, what's going on? And we went, hey man, how come I'm so happy though? And he was just like, ice. And we were like, what's that? He went, crystal. We went, crystal meth. And he was just like, yeah, it's the best. And we were like, oh, okay. That's pretty intense. Yeah, because considering you can get shot for weed and this guy's just like chilling, smoking crystal meth. But he left us alone after that. He didn't seem as desperate to get us to buy his weed after he'd had his crystal meth. We did, however, get the mushroom milkshakes, which was, yeah, that was, I think that was nice after we'd spent so many weeks like in this weird state. And I think we felt ready by that point to, you shouldn't do mushrooms, really, should you, unless you're in the correct headspace for it. And that doesn't mean that they always have to be celebratory, but it means like you've got something that you want to achieve with it. I've heard before from people. And Tanya just smashing up the treehouse in the background there. I think we felt as if this actually might help us to reconcile what's happened. I was gonna say what's happened to us, obviously it's not like didn't happen to us, but how we felt about it. That's right. So, yeah, we thought we'll have these mushrooms, and it was fantastic, man. It was already great, this little island. We were chilling, and we'd look over at the next island for like sunrise or sunset, and we'd go over and look at Gili Tea, and you know, we'd have a piña colada, or, you know, just like all the standard stuff that you would imagine we would do. or, you know, just like play a little acoustic guitar and get a fish curry or something. Like, we were having a great time. So we had these mushrooms and literally splashed in the sea like little kids. We were just splish splashing in the sea, just like.
Is it on the video?
I did make of it, yeah. I don't know if I will have hidden it or, you know, privatised it. Shall I show it?
You should definitely
show it.
This is us, if you're watching the video.
Where I'm just sat in the sea.
Yeah, we're just having a glorious time.
It just felt like you're a kid and you were experiencing that for the first time.
Yeah.
It was so good.
It was great. I remember at one point I was like thinking, you know, because we were just chilling in a hammock between two trees, chilling, thinking like, when are we going to come up off this thing? And then I went, whoa, the sand, like in my mind, I thought the sand's looking super purple in patches. Mm-hmm. But I thought, I must be imagining that. I went, Tanya, how's that sand look to you? You went, whoa, super purple though. And I was like, right. So it's like, we've unlocked the next level of sight. We've unlocked more colours available to us.
Any psychedelics, I think that you really, the best place to be is in just the most in nature you can possibly. If you're in any, for any sort of urban setting, it's kind of...
Yeah, there was nothing remotely like man-made in eyesight. Mm. And we were in the sea, a lightning storm starts out to sea, which definitely did happen, but at the time we were like, are we imagining the lightning storm?
Yeah.
Lightning striking the sea and we're just splashing in the sea, having a great time. And there's little crabbies running around. And we head over to the other side of the island. We get like banana pancakes for supper, for tea. And we're just like having the best time ever. And we were like, this was good. This was a great idea. Mm-hmm. And we're like, we'll go in the morning, I think. And we're running out of money and shit by this time. You know, it's been weeks in, but it's almost time to go. We're like, before we go, we've got to go and check out a sunrise. So we'll go in the morning, like 5, and we'll go and check out the sunrise. So we head over the next morning. We get up and it's dark still. Every night we'd been staying up watching Attack on Titan in bed together. You know, just like, think about something else. Escapism. It's not our lives. It's not, because, I mean, it was really, in retrospect, there's things that sound really nice, but we were still dealing, obviously, and you know, it's only a couple of weeks since our good friend had been killed, and every night we're still texting with people and trying to reassure them that we're okay and check if they're okay. But anyway, we head out and we go and check out this sunrise in the morning, and can't see it though. Big old cloud, like not just a big cloud, but like a big black cloud, not because it's black, coming from the next island. And we were like, what the fuck's going on? And we were like asking someone, what is that? What's going on? And she was like, oh yeah, the volcano on the next island has gone off. The volcano on Lombok has gone off. And we're like,
Rinjani.
Pardon? Rinjani, Mount Rinjani. I think that's right. Something. Well remembered. And I was like, oh, and that happens all the time? And they were like, no, that doesn't happen. I was like, oh. And I mean, but we're flying back in a couple of days though. So how's that going? And she was like, no, that's not going to. No, all the airports are definitely closed. And we were like, oh fuck. And I should have told you this. The plane tickets that we bought, Tanya had done that on her phone and downloaded them. And then at one point on this, while we were on the gillies, we were like, let's go and we're going to swim in the coral. We're going to touch turtles. We're going to finger turtles in this little turtle hole. Like, and we're just going, oh, this is the best time. And then we're like, let's take some footage. And to Tanya's credit, all the way round on this whole thing, I'd been taking pictures and videos with my camera, because I sort of treat traveling a little bit as like, oh, this is some cool shit happening, I'll make a video, and it sort of promotes it's like good to flex the creativity, but it also promotes what I do, because I make videos. Shaolin Pete on Instagram, shaolinpete.com, hire me for all your video. And then all the way, thanks man for backing me up. You didn't back me up, I'll remember that next time I buy Deliveroo, and it'll just be for me and it won't be for you. And then all the way around though, I'd been taking pictures and videos, and then Tanya had just found a slightly different angle with a phone, just like dip it over this way or just get the lens flare it, and I'd be looking at her screen going, that's well better than what I'm getting. So I started to go to her, do you mind if I use some of your stuff in my video? And she was like, sure, yeah. And I went, I'll credit you and everything, like I feel like I'm more of an editor than a cameraman anyway, so I'll use the best stuff available, and then I my touch will come in the edit, and then I'll say the footage was like half gotten by Tanya, or like you were the primary camera person or whatever. And she was like, yeah, go ahead. So I just put my camera away for a lot of it, and Tanya's shooting video and pictures and just like getting all the best shit. I'm like, this is going to make a wicked video. Even though Beef's dead, even though we didn't do the viral dance that was going to go viral, I promise you, kid. Now I'm still going to get a wicked video from Tanya's footage that she's getting on her phone. She's like, I'm going to get a turtle. I'm going to film under the water. I'm going to put it in a plastic bag, film under the water. We're going to film the cool underwater shit. We'd already done it when we'd been away to Croatia, other places. We'd filmed underwater. I mean, admittedly, I did break my camera when I put it in a bag and filmed under the water in Croatia. And then we were like, what are we going to do? We need to find a camera shop in Croatia. And I left it out in the sun and it was okay and it fixed. So Tanya's like test driving this. She's putting her phone in a bag in the sink in our little hut at Papaya, and she's dunking it. I'm going, when we tell this story, can I go on record that I suggested we don't do this because this is going to go wrong? When we tell this on the podcast, years from now. And Tanya's going, you never believe in anything I do, Pete, you don't trust me. And then I'm going, okay, I'm just saying, I recommended that you don't do it. I think that this is, I'm pretty dubious about this thing. She was like, oh, I'm going to do it anyway. And then she's dunking it, and it's getting water in the bag. And I'm like, it's got water in the bag, in the sink. And she's like, I didn't tape it yet, Pete. Always naysaying, sitting in your tower. You create something, you piece of shit.
She is like that.
She's exactly like that. It's a great impression. So we go in the sea anyway, and she's like trying to record shit. She pulls the phone out, dead. All the footage, all the plane tickets, gone. I was like, leave it out on the beach and it'll cook. Which we read later on is like the last thing that you want to do, because it cooks, it melts the fucking circuit board and like breaks down all the bonds inside the phone. I was like, yeah, it's going to like evaporate all the water out of it. So even if it wasn't dead, we left it on the beach and it was definitely dead after that, just cooked to a crisp. So cut back to when we learned that the volcano is erupting, has now closed all the airports and anything that we want to be able to do. There's no Wi-Fi on this place. Like there's no Wi-Fi and shit. So we wonder that Tanya's phone doesn't work. My phone's ridiculous. This is my new phone. People might recognize as a Samsung, what, Galaxy S5, something like that, which is like even better than the phone I had at the time. So I've always been like years behind on my phone. So we were just basically trapped and we didn't know what to do. And then we remembered when we'd replaced, oh, that was it. The original flight back that we got from like Bali to Jakarta, the original separate flight than the original flights. We were like, well, we're not going to need that now because it's not flying from the same place that we...
When we rebooked the flights, the flight was from Bali.
So yeah, we went, we'll just fly back from Bali. We don't need that Bali to Jakarta flight anymore that we'd originally booked to get back to Jakarta to fly, you know. Do you get what I'm saying? Like the original flights were in and out of Jakarta with a separate flight booked internally from Bali back to Jakarta, which we didn't need anymore because when we replaced the flights... Are you following, Sutton? That means the people at home, if you can follow it, definitely they can follow it. So yeah, we were like, we'll just fucking use that. We'll just jump on that shit little internal flight.
Yeah,
internal flights are still running because it was literally called, and this is not because it's Asian, Ryanair was the name of the, right? It was called Ryanair. Oh, Lionair.
Ryanair is like the English.
Yeah, Ryanair is the English one. So it was called Lionair, right?
Oh, and that's funny because they can't
say Lionair. Yeah, we fly on Lionair. And then, so we literally got on this little plane that was all dirty and there's people like hanging on the outside of the plane. No, there's no one on the outside of the plane. But I remember sitting on it and Tanya and I have still got this idea that we're going to die at any moment. And I remember looking out the window at the turbine, not turbines because they're Asian, they weren't wearing the turbines. And the turbine's super dirty and it's just like so weak that if you'd have been thrown into this turbine, you wouldn't have been injured. That's how pathetic this turbine was.
We knew that there was a lot of ash in the air because of all...
Yeah, so that's why the airports all closed. The proper airports were like, we're not flying through this ash cloud. The planes are going to crash. And Lionel was like, don't worry about the ash in the air. We just clean it. And then... there was a point where I'm sat and then there was a woman next to me, a local as well, looking out the window as we were setting off, and Tanya's here, sat on this side of me, and the local woman was like going, doing the Jesus thing, the cross, invisible, whatever that's called. What's that called? Do you know what it's called? She was doing that. She was doing the
Father and the Holy Ghost.
Like as if we were going to crash. A local did not have faith in the Lionel. So I was like going, ha ha ha, like turning to Tanya like, ha ha, we're going to be okay, aren't we, Pap? And then So we fly, and we're okay. We fly into Jakarta, and I mean, I'm bringing the story to a close because we got back into Jakarta, and I mean, well, I'd lost so much weight, by the way, on the way, just like from sleep deprivation and just the emotional trauma of what had happened to us, and not eating, and food poisoning, and just walking around every day. So fitness was probably, and just sweating buckets all the time, and just like sleeping in 35 degree. And so I'd lost like stones and stones. You could see my jawline cut like I was back in high school again. And I was just eating like a pot noodle a day by the end of it. Do you remember this? I was just like one pot noodle, just like starving away I was. And then I got like pretty brutal food poisoning, and I just ransacked the airport toilet on the way back to get the plane to come back home. And we stayed in this little, like, I think they have them in the UK as well, but you stay in a hotel where it's literally just a tiny little room that's completely filled by a bed and a tiny little toilet, and it's, you just stay there while you're waiting for your plane, and there's no space to do anything, and it's so cheap. And I'm just like obliterating this toilet with a wafer thin door separating me and Tanya, earlier on in our relationship as well, so we still weren't farting in front of each other and stuff. Now I'll just be like pull my cheek and like grab a hand and fart on a hand for a laugh, but we weren't doing that back then. So I was just going blah, 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 just orange smoothie, just carpet bombing this toilet. Had to throw away my pants, like my boxers, and Tanya's just like ostensibly sleeping in the next room or pretending to, just like like covering her mouth and nose. Killed the airport toilets. I don't know if I told you about this, but I go in the cubicle at the airport, busy, you know, Jakarta, Indonesian, like airport bathroom, and I'm in there. And then I remember just like, no flush. There's like a weird, no toilet paper even. There's like this weird water thing you have to wash yourself with. And then I open the door and it had just been evacuated, cleared everyone out of that thing. And then I remember trying to keep it in, like, oh my God, I need to hold this in until I can take a shit on the aeroplane, right? Because you have to wait like half an hour in between like boarding, and you can't immediately go to the toilet. And I'm like, can I hold it in? Am I going to shit myself in my seat? And I'm waiting, trying to pound waters in the meantime because it makes you super dehydrated being food poisoned, right? And then, dong, you can get up, and I sprint, jump, leaping over people, hurdling guys to get to the toilet. Can't do a shit though when I get down to the airport toilet. I'm like, oh, that's weird. Oh, that's really weird. I've got some sort of stage fright, performance anxiety. Don't know what's going on. Go and sit down. This is a long flight. 12 hours something. What is it? 11 hours? I don't shit on that flight while I've got food poisoning. Because I remember filling up my pants while we were sitting, having a burger, waiting to get the plane at one point. So I had severe poop poisoning. You just take a minute to imagine the poo there. And then, I mean, I don't know why I include this part of the story, but we get back home and I don't take a shit for days. And I'm starting to get worried. I'm like, oh, I'll take some laxatives and do things that I would always do if I'm trying to, like, get some Weetabix in you, have a curry maybe, cycle, run, go to the gym and, like, try and get it to shake out. I'm literally eating laxatives that my dad needs because he's on, like, all kinds of medication. He needs laxatives. So I'm, like, scranning these laxatives in handfuls and like drinking stuff, no poo's coming out. I'm like, that's just built, there's something blocking and it's building. I'm gonna have to go and get a cesarean at this rate to get this poo out of me. And then I mean, the story doesn't end very excitingly. In the end, I just had a poo and a little bit of poo. I thought it was gonna go like just but just normal, it just a little poo came out and then more started to come. But anyway, it's a happy ending. Chuck, is that picture? So, yeah. A year ago today, Jordan gave me this picture. Yeah, he gave a picture. It's me and Beef. Do you want to hold that? Get it right to the camera. There you go. That's me and Beef, my dream guest. Oh, and both your hands have been included, haven't they? That's the love. Now get it out of the way. Back to me. It's my show.
That's the love.
So, yeah. So yeah, anyway, the guy didn't, he kept protesting the fact that Beef's body should be given back to his parents, and he was going, do the toxicology on him, even though he definitely knew that he was drunk and he had drugs in his system. He was like, yeah, you know that family's poor son that's been killed, please will you keep prolonging this misery for them so they can't have a funeral and do toxicology on his blood so I could maybe get a lighter sentence. And his funeral took ages to happen, so that's...
But you ended up making it to it.
I suppose that's the silver lining, isn't it?
It is.
We ended up going to his funeral. Paul Baird for him.
We did.
Good times. Yeah. Sad. Sad. Don't tell that story. I'll wrap this up. So, I mean, we trailed off a little bit there at the end, but the story's told now. So if anyone's ever wondering about that story or parts from it, I'll just go, you are to consult episode 88. I very much appreciate you all sticking around for the whole episode. And yeah, why don't you check out some more episodes in future if you don't want to miss them. You are to bash the old button there somewhere knocking about.
Do a like, a subscribe, comment.
It's not wrong what he said. All that stuff does help me out. I very much appreciate it. Any engagement takes a little bit of time for you, and it boosts all my numbers in that this thing that we're building up. I hope that you were entertained by the story. I enjoyed telling it, actually. I've enjoyed having you guys in to recount it. We don't always go on about it because it can get a little bit sad. I'm sure we missed a lot out. Did we miss anything?
Probably
loads. You got anything to add, Sutton?
Stop Asian hate, nibble the wealthy.
Yeah, nibble the wealthy. Don't hate Asians. It's not their fault that they're Asian. That's what a dinner lady said to me one time. Like, my best mate in primary school was a black man, right? He was African descent, right? JC, this guy who's called. And so we're just like bantering with little kid banter. He's like, you're made out of milk. I was like, you're made out of poo. Something like that. Just like... nothing to do with his race, just like, you're brown like poo is as a child. Just, do you know what I mean? Like, he was my good friend. Obviously, if I thought any less of him, I'm not hanging out with that. I just, you don't even see it when you're that age. I was just like, hi, I'm white, you're brown, that's funny, different, innit? But I can't have understood what his experience will have been, where he's actually experiencing genuine racism here and there from like adults, like fucking weird dickhead adults or whatever. So he's upset when I say it, and I didn't even understand it at the time. But I remember him running to the dinner lady, and he's crying, going, oh, Peter said I was made out of poo because I'm black. And I was just, I couldn't really understand it, but the dinner lady looked at me and went, Peter, he's crying now. Like, stood there with him, looking at me, and she went, he's crying now. Why have you said that? It's not his fault, he's black. And I remember looking, even at that age, I was like, that's not the thing here. That's not what should be said. But yeah, don't hate Asians, it's not their fault that they're just little yellow idiots, you know. Happy Pride Month, thanks for checking it out. Check out last week's episode with Paddy, that was a solid one. Any with Sutton? Check out Sutton's podcast, Saying Sutton podcast. Couple good poddies with old Tanya B in there. And check yourself out before you wreck yourself out. See you later.